Studios at WVON. We're
your original social media.
You're listening to American Heroes, hosted by Cliff Kelley on WVON AM 1690.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. This is the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON. I'm Cliff Kelley. It is September 22nd. We are on iHeartRadio. All you need to do is download the app to your smartphone or tablet and take us with you wherever. You can also go to WVON.com. And, of course, you can call us direct, 773-591-1690. And, of course, you can get social, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. America's Heroes Group was, of course, created for engaging, empowering, connecting, and transforming veterans by being the hub to veterans affairs, information, resources, and referrals. And today, of course, we have a special show, which I will tell you about in a moment, but we are proudly sponsored by Seidman Law Firm, AARP Foundation, Pearl's Place. And today, as I said, something special, we are live on Facebook. And we are proud to announce America's Heroes Group is partnering with Jesse Brown VA. And we created this organization, as I mentioned, to show, 2 years ago, for veterans, armed forces, and family members to have a platform to speak your truth to your power. And we are so pleased to have a number of guests today. But first, in fact, he's going to be running the show. We have the director of the Jesse Brown VA, Mark McGill. And this gentleman was appointed center director at Jesse Brown VA Medical Center in October of 2016. He joined the VA over 32 years ago and has held leadership positions in so many places all over the country. And if I talked about all the things that this wonderful gentleman has done and is doing, we wouldn't have time for the show. But Mr. McGill holds a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration from Millikan University in Decatur, Illinois, and a Master of Science in Healthcare Administration from Trinity University in San Antonio, Texas. He is a recipient of the President's Council of Management Improvement Award, a graduate of the VHA Healthcare Leadership Institute, and Executive Career Field Class of 2003. And we are so pleased to be connected with this wonderful organization and this great gentleman. How are you today?
Just great, Cliff. Really good to be back on the show. And I'd like to thank you again and WVON or America's Heroes Groups just for giving us a platform that we can talk about services that are important to our veterans. Today, is about a topic that is of great importance, because it's a topic that is not talked about very often. And it's a topic that actually can, if it's not talked about, can be a barrier for our veterans to come and get many needed services, whether those are medical or mental health services. So that topic is military sexual trauma. And very complicated. And so what I'm going to do is hopefully what a good director would do is bring an expert with him. And we definitely have an expert today. We have Dr. Angel Buchanan. Dr. Buchanan's a clinical psychologist at Jesse Brown, and she is head of our military sexual trauma program. So, Dr. Buchanan.
Thank you so much. Hi.
You're good. So happy to have you here, Doctor.
Thanks so much. Mm-hmm. It's truly an honor to be here as part of the military sexual trauma coordinator at Jesse Brown. You know, part of my role is to meet with military sexual trauma survivors to help help assist them in getting connected to treatment resources, to really focus on their MST and to help them with the ways in which it's affected them. And in meeting with these veterans, I've really learned, and I've heard over and over again, how they often feel like they're not believed, or they fear they may not be believed, and also a concern that this topic is not spoken about more. And so it's truly an honor to be here. And my hope is really that I can help, along with these survivors, spread awareness about military sexual trauma, or MST, because I really think that spreading awareness is part of what our community can do to reduce the barriers to people really getting the help that not only that they need, but that they're entitled to. These are veterans who served our country. So, you know, part of what I will do today is really talk about what we know about military sexual trauma, how frequent it occurs, the VA services that are offered, but I think even more powerful is actually having survivors bring their stories to it. I think, you know, I am aware that I am a clinician, and so there's power in providing a background. But I do think, as someone who meets with these veterans, the power is truly recognizing that these are humans. These are veterans being affected by military sexual trauma. And I think I'm very honored that we have two veterans here today, two survivors. One is an Army and Navy veteran who will be speaking later today about her experience of military sexual trauma and how it affected her. Her name is Terry Odom, so we'll hear from her later today. But then also we have a male survivor who's an Army veteran, and he's an African-American male who is engaged in Jesse Brown therapy. So he's, for today, going to go by the name of Lynn, but I'm really glad to have them on the air to really bring out the human aspect of really how military sexual trauma can affect our veterans, and why, as a community, raising awareness and addressing stigma, addressing some of those myths, is an important part of helping these veterans feel better. So again, thank you for having me.
I think this is great. Mark, where should we go from here? She's given us some great information already. Should she continue now? Or
yes, let's go ahead. And did you want to talk just a little bit as far as the definition?
Yeah, that would be great.
Sure thing. So per U.S. code, military sexual trauma, also known as MST, so you'll hear me use the term MST moving forward, is defined by any type of repeated sexual harassment, any unwanted sexual attention, unwanted sexual touch, and sexual assault that occurred during a veteran's military service. So when it comes to the survivor, it doesn't matter whether the survivor is a female, a male. It doesn't matter whether that survivor was on or off base. If it occurred during their military service, it's considered MST. It's also really important to know that perpetrators could be within the military, it could be a subordinate or a higher ranking official or a group of those individuals. The perpetrators can be civilians, perpetrators can be men, women, and perpetrators have been significant others. So truly the circumstances and of the MST, that varies, but the definition is important that if any type of repeated sexual harassment or sexual assault occurred during someone's service, that is MST. And at the VA, when someone says, I've experienced MST, we believe them. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I'm very proud of as a VA employee, because a lot of these survivors talk about their fear of not being believed. And right. The moment that someone enrolls into VA care, part of the mandate is for us to ask, you know, is this something that you've experienced? Have you experienced MST? And if someone says yes, we don't need proof. Mm-hmm. We believe them and we move forward with trying to get them the help that they need.
I'm glad you say you ask, because I'm sure a lot of people don't even want to mention it. Mm-hmm. They don't want to bring it up. That happens in civilian life when people, you know, are raped or whatever, and this sort of thing. In fact, we're talking about that right now with the Supreme Court nominee, you know, and the lady who was talking about what happened when they were in high school. But it's just great. You do ask.
Yes.
Can you give us... Is there any statistics about the percentage, Dr. Buchanan, relative to how many people in the service suffer this?
Yes. So the numbers that we have, we suspect, are underestimates. So it's mm-hmm. it's very hard right. to know what the real numbers are, because
some people aren't going to tell you.
Exactly.
Right.
So mm-hmm. as you're saying, as Director McGill was saying, there are a lot of barriers to reporting. Mm-hmm. Many of them are external. Some of them are internal. And I think it's important to know what these barriers are, because they can really affect someone's ability of actually saying, I experienced MST. When we think about the military in many great ways is so well known to be about brotherhood, sisterhood, cohesion, being with the unit, and putting the collective over the individual. This works, and this has been such a great attribute of the military for so many people. For military sexual trauma survivors, this can be a very difficult thing for many reasons. I think when someone experiences MST, one of the difficulties is wondering if they're going to be believed by the collective, and or if they're not going to be believed, or if there are really going to be negative consequences. And I have mm-hmm. heard so many examples of retaliation against someone reporting MST to their unit or to their superior, because it really affects that unit's cohesion.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's also fear of being placed outside of one's unit and being removed from a source of support after experiencing MST, which has happened. And so I think that's one of the reasons people don't always want to report.
Could another reason be, and you would have the statistics on this, that the perpetrator is a senior?
Yes.
You know, somebody who is has rank over the victim.
Yes, this is actually a great point. This person can be, you know, a higher ranking mm-hmm. officer that is in power and control and right. affects that person's military career. It could be a comrade, in which case sometimes there's really no boundaries between work and personal life, where a lot of times survivors have to be around their perpetrators after they've experienced mm-hmm. MST.
And I think another thing, once that trust has been eroded, I know it's hard, even, you know, when our veterans receive services, it's hard to gain that trust back. And that's important, I think, when go through the programs and try to get treatment, correct?
Yes, yes. I think, you know, if we think about the military, we're thinking you're supposed to trust
right.
your buddy to be mm-hmm. there to protect you and to support you. And when that trust is broken in some ways, whether that the perpetrator is in the military or whether reporting to the military is a terrible experience, mm-hmm. I think that really affects someone's ability to trust other people. And that can be VA providers, that could be any providers, that could be family, friends. I mean, that could really affect relationships. And so part of the work is instilling, you know, demonstrating that we can be trusted.
You are a clinical psychologist, and you can help these people, and I'm sure you do. But when people are still on active duty, that's got to be really difficult for them.
I would, you know, that's, you know, what I hear.
Yeah,
that's,
right. Thank goodness they can come to, you know, Jesse Brown VA, and, you know, and you're going to take care of it. But, you know, Dr. Buchanan, I can just see if you are still in the unit, there'd be all kinds of reasons for you not to to say anything.
Absolutely. And I think that leads to, you know, just those difficulties often prevent people from reporting, or
sure,
often lead to negative experiences of reporting. Mm-hmm. And if we think about how that's going to turn inward for someone, mm-hmm, that can lead to a lot of fear. It can lead to a lot of shame and embarrassment. So going back to what you were asking about the numbers, again, the numbers we have are probably underestimates, but mm-hmm, what we do have is that approximately 1 in 4 women in the military have, wow, reported military sexual trauma, and 1 in 100 men. And so clearly the proportions are different, but there are just so many more men in the military that when we look at the numbers, they're actually quite similar.
Similar, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
and,
right.
And we see,
sure,
that at Jesse Brown,
sense,
too. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to know that this is not a female issue. This is not a male-only issue. This is an everyone issue. Truly, yeah, it is.
Another question relative to that. Is this MST doctor homosexual, heterosexual? Are there any comparisons there?
When it comes to the sexual orientation of survivors,
yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
You know, I would say the research is limited, but I think what we,
and also the perpetrators,
with the perpetrators, that
both,
research is limited.
Okay.
What I can say from my clinical experience, mm-hmm, is that there's no the association between sexual orientation and MST is that people who are of the LGBT community and are survivors, they're often targets of MST, not because of their sexual orientation, but because of the discrimination against it. You know, I think it's really important, and I'm so glad you bring this up, because a lot of us improving the care and the environment for survivors is addressing some of these myths and stigma.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sexual trauma is not about sexual attraction. Mm-hmm. It's not about sexual orientation.
Right.
It's about power and control.
Right.
It's about an individual or a group of individuals, you know, trying to enforce power and control over someone else. And so it really does not have to do with sexual orientation, because if we're thinking about sexual orientation, we're thinking, who is someone attracted to,
right?
Right?
Right.
It's really about that power and control and trying to or essentially degrade another human being.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's such a great question. Of the limited information we know, it's just that LGBTQ individuals are targeted because of discrimination.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I think also, you know, because sometimes people think sexual trauma is about attraction rather than power and control, again, this turns inwards on the survivors, and it affects,
sure,
the survivors terribly, yeah, of questioning their so-called masculinity or femininity, mm-hmm, and their strength or weakness or their sexual orientation. And I think that's where we could really make a positive impact, is addressing these myths and stigmas that it's not about attraction.
Right.
It's
just
really
like
about
rape.
Power.
Rape is,
right,
not about attraction. Yeah, that's
right.
That's forced.
Absolutely.
I'm sure you're doing, you know, you folks over there do such a great job. People that do talk to you, Dr. Buchanan, what kind of treatment is put forth to help them?
So each VA is a bit different, but okay, what I could say nationally, what's VA mandated is that all veterans are asked if they've experienced,
good,
MST. And,
mm-hmm,
for those who say yes, we believe them.
Mm-hmm.
And for those who say yes, they are entitled to and deserve free MST-related care for the rest of their life from the VA.
Great.
So that can be mental health treatment. That could be physical health treatment, because there are lots of physical health treatment conditions associated with MST. And that also includes medication. For those who say no to that initial question of have you experienced MST, again, we believe people when they say that, but we just make sure to ask every year in case there are barriers there preventing them to disclose. And then also across the VA, there's mandatory training for primary care providers and for mental health providers to be what we call MST competent. So to, one, know about what MST is, how it affects veterans in different ways, and how to sensitively ask about it and incorporate it into treatment. When it comes to Jesse Brown, I am very proud to say we have a number of MST-specific services. All of our individual therapists and psychiatrists on staff are MST competent. And also we have some MST specific group therapy options. There's a female survivors group, and there are also male survivors groups as well. Because oftentimes, you know, people who've experienced sexual trauma don't feel safe around a certain sex or gender.
When you said, Dr. Buchanan, that there are different services in different areas, I was going to say, well, I know Jesse Brown is number one. And you just proved that, you know. And that's just great. They could get health services paid for as long as they need it. That's just great.
And actually, yeah. I wanted to reiterate that. So from the standpoint of eligibility, if you're a veteran and you believe you've experienced military sexual trauma, there are no eligibility requirements to receive care.
Oh, that's great.
Right. If there are some veterans who are not eligible for VA care otherwise, but if they've experienced MST and have at least served one day of active duty and has had a type of discharge that's honorable, they can still be eligible for MST-related
care.
That's
wonderful. We will be back. We are so pleased to have Mr. Mark McGill, who is, of course, the head of the Jesse Brown VA Medical Center, doing a great job. And you just heard from Dr. Angel Buchanan. And we're talking about a very serious issue, and we're so pleased to have them here in the studio. And as I mentioned earlier, we are also today, we are on the Facebook. We're on Facebook Live. Stay with us. We'll be back with more in just a moment.
When you see news happening, call the WVON News Now tip line at 773-336-3415 or send an email to news@wvon.com.
America, sweet.
Hi, this is Cliff Kelley, WVON host and honored veteran, inviting you to listen every Saturday from 4 to 5 p.m. as I host America's Heroes Group, where we speak truth to power regarding the treatment of veterans, retired and active, discussing concerns for affordable housing, social services, Medicare, and all services geared toward veterans. America's Heroes Group, where we speak truth to power. Hi, this is Cliff Kelley, the host of America's Heroes Group. If you or a loved one has been injured in an accident or the result of malpractice, you have only one chance to get the compensation you deserve. You need a law firm you can trust with experience and resources who will fight on your behalf. With a proven track record of excellence both in and out of the courtroom, call Seidman, Margulis, and Fairman at 312-781-1977 for a free consultation, or visit SeidmanLaw.net. That's Seidman, S-E-I-D-M-A-N, Law.net.
Hi, I'm O.S. Owen, the volunteer recruiter for the AARP Foundation Experience Corps. AARP Foundation is proud to partner and sponsor America's Heroes Group. Hey, Cliff, veterans matter, and they're one of the great pillars of our communities across this great country.
As a veteran and host of America's Heroes Group, I totally endorse AARP Foundation Experience Corps Volunteer in guiding the next generation of readers.
We both agree veterans would make great volunteers for our children.
Hi, I'm Cliff Kelley, veteran and host of America's Heroes Group.
Hi, I'm Chuck Bourne, veteran and advisory board member of America's Heroes Group. Veterans, family members, and community.
Please join America's Heroes Group every last Saturday of the month for a buffet dinner at Pearl's Place, starting at 6 p.m. until 7:30 p.m.
We can't think of a better place to eat on Saturday than Pearl's Place.
The following is a paid program. The opinions expressed are those solely of the broadcaster and not necessarily those of WVON.
WVON.com. The website. Check it out.
On Saturday, September 22nd. Happy fall, autumn, everybody. First day of autumn. I'm Cliff Kelley, of course, and this is America's Heroes Group, and we are continuing. This is a special, very special program we have today, and we are on Facebook Live and with the gentleman who's doing such a great job at the VA Medical Center, the Jesse Brown VA Medical Center. The director there, Mark McGill, is with us. And again, thank you so much for being here. And you just heard from Dr. Angel Buchanan. And this whole situation with this problem of PST is something. But when you hear people like Dr. Buchanan saying what she says, that we know that there's help there. And just think it's great what you said. And you have somebody else, Doc, you want to bring on?
Yeah, you know, I think it's clear that MST is a problem, and I think it's clear that it affects people. But I also hope that people come away with this, that things can feel better and there are services for MST. The person who I am going to introduce next is Terry Odom, and she is a U.S. Army and Navy veteran. Terry is just such a great symbol of post-traumatic resilience. We discussed, both Terry and I, earlier that I will tell her MST experience, and then I'll hand it over to Terry. But, you know, I do think it's important to say that we are talking about trauma here, and also more specifically sexual trauma. And so if people are listening and they're noticing feeling overwhelmed, that's not unusual. Trauma is an emotional shock. It is overwhelming. It's not something we're supposed to feel used to. So just please pay attention to how you're feeling. And so I do want to talk about Terry's MST, because I think it demonstrates the reality of what MST can be like. And then I'll hand it over to Terry to really talk about her experience about that.
Sure,
but so during her service, Terry became friends with a higher-ranking non-commissioned officer who was older. He was married, and he was like a father figure to her. On one night, Terry had to leave a social event early, as she had duty. Then they offered to walk her home. It was nighttime. So once they reached her apartment, he asked to sleep on the couch, something that he had done numerous times before, and they had gone to base the next day, you know. But on this night, what was different was that he proceeded to physically assault her, rape her, and torture Terry in her apartment bathroom. So, you know, I really think it's this particular event was really gruesome and it was really prolonged. Terry woke up the next day and went to base because she had duty and she didn't want to be considered AWOL.
Mm-hmm.
And she reported the MST to various superiors, which, you know, for some people, again, like we said, there are barriers, but she actually did report the MST to various superiors and they either made kind of misogynist comments or they threatened to have her arrested for illegally reporting a crime against another service member. Eventually, she was actually arrested, and she was psychiatrically hospitalized. And while she was hospitalized, she was told she was pregnant, and she was forced to have an abortion because apparently that was too much evidence of the MST. I do think it's, you know, worth mentioning, she was forced to have an abortion on her own dime. She was promised that she could continue her military career if she participated in an alcohol treatment program, even though she did not have an alcohol use disorder. And I think something that's from her childhood, Terry had dreamed of serving her country and being in the military. And she was first in her class, in every class.
Wow.
And so it was important for her to continue her military career. This is something that was she saw for herself. Mm-hmm. So she agreed to do this. But one of the program providers told her that she didn't have a substance use disorder when she went to that alcohol treatment program. And so she was sent back to base and informed her psychiatrist about what this provider had said. And this psychiatrist ended up discharging Terry honorably with a mental health diagnosis that would prevent her from ever reenlisting. And so, for Terry, this was the end of her military career. And I just think this her story really highlights not just how terrible MST can be, but how afterwards the way that she was treated was also so terrible. After years of struggling with post-traumatic stress, Terry actually has become a national speaker about MST, about post-traumatic stress, about suicide prevention, and she's an advocate in so many different, initiatives. And she's also a full-time volunteer as a veterans advisor at the St. Louis VA.
Great.
Right. So Terry has become an advocate since, she experienced MST. And I think this is how she's such a symbol of post-traumatic resilience. So, I think what's important, again, is to really remember that these are humans who are experiencing this. And so I really want to hand this over to Terry to really give a voice to this experience. So,
Terry, thanks for joining us.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Buchanan. And thank you, Mr. McGill, and thank you, sir. And it is true. There are many, many challenges to reporting sexual assault while still in the military. I mean, you have so many different laws, different rules, and honestly, you don't want to let your unit down, first and foremost. I mean, it's a tight bond, and it's, it's different than any civilian could ever possibly understand. I know it sounds as simple as dialing 911, but that's not how the military operates. And also, in my particular case, and in many, my perpetrator was married, so that automatically made me also part of the crime, because in the military, adultery is a crime. Mm-hmm. So just the simple fact that my rapist was married meant that I committed a crime, no fault of mine, obviously, because he was married, and that's adultery. And when I did report to the highest person on base at that, it was a weekend, I was on duty, which wasn't the commander of the base, it was the XO, which is second command.
Mm-hmm.
His first question to me was, were you wearing perfume? Because you smell like you have perfume on. And I think even though it hadn't even been 24 hours at that point, I kind of thought this is not going to be, this is going to be more of a challenge than I even thought. And I was still in shock and desperately in need of medical treatment, which I did not receive. I was bleeding vaginally and had superficial stab wounds. I think they counted 32 by the time I got to Germany. And I'm sorry?
No, go right ahead.
So it didn't turn out so well for me. I was threatened with arrest for falsely accusing another service member with a crime, and that I did not need to tarnish a good man's career. He was getting ready to retire with full military benefits, which he actually did. So I was actually sent home for 3 days back to the apartment where it happened, the scene of the crime. And they told me, just go home, take some aspirin, chill out, better think this hard and through, because you could spend the rest of your life in the brig. That's a lot to go through. So I went back to my apartment where it happened. I would not shower nor go in that bathroom. And for 3 days, I tried to kill myself several ways, but obviously I failed. And I lived close to the ocean. And the only thing that I knew to do was to keep walking and not swim. And every time that I would go underwater and felt like I didn't have any breath left, I don't know if it was survival mode or what happened, but every time I would come back up for air and go back to shore. And so 3 days later, I did go back to base. And I still had several of the bruises and stuff like that. They had actually started to turn yellow by then. And I actually faced my perpetrator. And the only thing that he said was, "I can't believe that you lived through that." And I told him that I had reported him, and he said, "You know, I can finish this if you want me to," and he meant kill me. And at that point, I was actually in a military vehicle because I worked for Public Works. At that time, I was actually in the Seabees in the Navy at the construction battalion. And I drove to the chaplain. I didn't know what else to do. I thought, if I can't get any help from the legal part or my chain of command or anyone else, maybe if I just go talk to a chaplain, because I felt so suicidal and so, I didn't know where to turn, honestly. And so I went to the chaplain, told him exactly what happened, and he asked me if I was suicidal. I said yes. And he excused himself, and the next thing I know, two shore patrol came in with handcuffs and placed me under arrest. Because not only are you a service member, but you're also a piece of government property. So if you threaten suicide, that's damaging government property. That was me at that time. And so I was put in handcuffs, back of an ambulance, and actually had to go sit in jail to wait until the next medevac flight went to Germany. And once again, I still received no medical treatment. I did receive bread and water and aspirin. So by the time I got to Germany, I still had the same dirty and bloody uniform on, the only thing that I had on my back when I left. And I had to wait in Germany for 9 days to get a medevac flight back to the United States. And all I remember at Germany was being scolded by a senior officer who also was a physician, that I smelled and I was soiled, and that, you know, that did I have another uniform? And I didn't. That's all I told him. That's all I had is what's on my back. Fast forward, I was medevaced eventually to the U.S. and put on a psychiatric ward, given all kinds of psychiatric medication in Germany. And furthermore, and I had never taken anything above a Tylenol in my life at that point. And that's where I was found to be pregnant. And my treating psychiatrist, MD behind her name, of course, mm-hmm. told me that, you know, that the military does not pay for abortions, but if you'll have one, that's the only thing that'll save your career, because there's just too much evidence of being raped, and you cannot have that on your record or you will be discharged. So she asked me, do you want to stay military? If you do, all you have to do is have the abortion. We'll put you in handcuffs. We'll take you in an ambulance. I'll wait for an off-duty Air Force nurse to go with you to Georgetown, and you'll pay cash. And that's what I did.
I tell you, Miss Odom, I'm just glad you doing what you're doing as a veteran advisor at the VA St. Louis Healthcare Center, because I'm not sure what all that you've been through that you'd want anything to do with the military. This is and for this guy to tell you, I don't know how you survived that, what I did to you. You know, oh my goodness. And he retired with full honors, right?
He retired with full benefits. And, you know, I can understand his thought, because, like I said, he stabbed me so many times. Yeah. And I did end up with a skull fracture from a beating with a hammer. But by the time I got to the VA, I didn't have, like Mr. McGill said, I absolutely had zero trust in any form of government or medical yeah. provider, civilian or otherwise.
And Cliff, yeah. I got to tell you, I just so much appreciate Terry and her
yes.
story. And she yeah. has been so helpful to veterans in Chicago
Great.
And St. Louis. So, Terry, it's nice to talk to you again.
Terry, we certainly appreciate you being on. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, my goodness. That is really a story.
Yeah.
And by the way, I still love our military, okay?
You're great.
The hardest day of my life was taking off my uniform, so I don't have any regrets.
I
don't.
You're great, Terry.
Yeah.
Wow.
Again, she brings so much awareness to the actual problem.
Yeah.
And I also want to introduce this other veteran that we have on the line. He's an Army veteran who's a patient at the Jesse Brown VA. Today he's going by the name Lynn. So Lynn, please, tell us about your story or how it's affected you.
Hi, Lynn. Well, hey, how are you guys?
Good. Thanks for joining us.
Well, thank you for acknowledging the fact that we're willing to speak briefly about some of our experiences. Well, I went into the military at the age of 18. My mother waived my rights to go in. I didn't want to go to high school. And so still going in, I went in with a childish mindset at the age of 18, innocent. And fast forwarding to AIT, I remember staying on base in some of the housing. And I remember, rather than putting another soldier my age into the housing room with me, they put an adult man in the room with me. And during the early morning hours, I was sexually assaulted. I had already been trained, so I'll be not as graphic, but as detailed as I possibly can. You know, we go in, primary MOS is you're trained to kill. And coming out of the service, I did report it while I was in there. Unfortunately, no paperwork can be found. So coming home, everything that they had trained me to do, I started using it in the streets. I was very homophobic. So in other words, mm-hmm. because the military did not assist me with my situation, mm-hmm. I took it out on society. Extremely violent. I began drinking, using drugs. As right now today, I'm still very homophobic. I'd like to thank God for the Jesse Brown VA, especially Dr. Joseph Yount. If it was not for the help that I'm getting with the group I'm in, I know I would be somewhere in someone's prison again because of my violent nature. Do I resent the Army? No. I love the Army, as Ms. Terry stated. But I do resent our government. I like to elaborate briefly on what Dr. Buchanan said. Never knew it. In 2010, I sought help from the VA, one Jesse Browning, tonight, but I just heard Dr. Brennan say if you serve just one day, we were entitled to help. They denied me. They denied me. They denied me. I got out of them. I reported this in 1982. I kept being denied, denied. The reason being, so you can't get help, sir. You're a reservist. I didn't go to war. I didn't do a straight 90 days, but I my EIT and basic, that was active duty. Mm-hmm. So what's being told to me is one day active, one day. So they consider the one day of basic training active, but I did do 90 days. I did over 90 days considering the basic and EIT, but they're giving me counseling, but I never got benefits. I was a homeless vet. I still consider myself to be that vet, a homeless vet. Not only was I homeless, I was out here doing unthinkable things just to ease the pain. Went in innocent. So, yes, the pain is there. I'm still hurting, but I'm grateful that I'm now able to get help. But I had to go somewhere else to be diagnosed as having a severe case of PTSD before they would see me. So I'm not lashing out at Jesse Brown. I'm lashing out at this broken system. Mm-hmm. The system is broken. I had suppressed everything. But in 2010, my son said, Dad, I want to be like you. I want to go in the Army. He had just graduated. And then that's when I had my flashback. I had my flashback. I had suppressed everything. I'm standing outside now in Quincy, Illinois, at the college. My nephews played football today, and I'm crying. I have students walking past mine because to be on the phone speaking to you all about this is bringing up so much pain, so much pain. I'm 53 years old. Mm-hmm. I'm 53, and I'm still living with this pain. I'm begging for benefits. I can't get medical benefits. What man would want to admit to something like this? What proud man? I come from a proud family. My mother's a retired sheriff. My sister's a sheriff. Family of veterans. But the morning that happened to me, the only person I could call was my mom. She was a Cook County sheriff at the time. It's a shame my mother had to write a note for me here, her 40-year-old son at that time, to say, hey, look, here's his proof. He called me. But right now, the government's telling me, and my claims are being denied. Prove it, prove it. There's no proof, there's no proof. My broken heart is the proof. Me being homophobic is the proof. Me using drugs, I was addicted to crack cocaine. A full-blown alcoholic, I'm dealing with stage 4 cirrhosis of the liver because of how I drank. I'm one leg in the grave, and I'm still crying, help me.
Wow.
Help me.
Lynn, that,
Yeah, Lynn, you know, I think what you're speaking about really demonstrates how it's not just the MST sometimes for people, it's kind of the aftermath. And I do want to clarify my comment earlier, because mm-hmm. to be really forthcoming, I am not an eligibility pro. You know, there are things that are beyond my competency regarding who's eligible for VA care. The information I would want to put out there is, you know, our eligibility office, which is on the first floor of Jesse Brown. It, you know, people sometimes think are unsure whether or not they're eligible for VA care. And so yeah. that's a resource that's there. But thank you so much for sharing.
Lynn, we certainly do appreciate you and keep it up. And I'm glad Jesse Brown is taking care of you. That is something.
Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you so much. And God bless you also. Before we close out, by these stories, you know, it's just so great that Jesse Brown is doing the job that they're doing. Let's ask Director Mark Miguel, is there something you'd like to say to our audience?
I'd like to say that we have many experts like Dr. Buchanan.
She's
and
great.
Many services. And one thing, we will believe you, and we will listen, and we'll help you get the medical or the behavioral health services that you may need. And so please call if it's an eligibility issue. We partner with the regional office, and we'll help work through that as well. So just want to pledge to all of our veterans in the Chicago area that Jesse Brown will be there for you. And thank you. It's an honor to serve our veterans.
well, it's an honor what you folks are doing too, because as we have talked before, we've been in contact, obviously, but the attitude that people have to Jesse Brown has improved so much since you've been there, and all the great folks. Yeah, it really has, and we love what you're doing, you know. So anyway, this has been great, and thank you all for being here, and go right ahead.
Yep. So if you need to reach us, I'm at America's Heroes Group. We have a new website we want to announce today, and that is americashg.org, americashg.org. Go and check out our new website. We can see this story and many others, and also see our podcast. We are also available on Facebook, Twitter, and now Ustream. So we want to give a special thanks to Manny Correza. Did I say his name right? He is our technical, one of our producers for our social media, and also he is part of social media team. Thank you, Manny Correza.
Great. And thank you, Sean. And of course, we thank Glenda Smith, our producer, our executive producer. Joseph Luckett is our technical producer today. Thank you, Joseph. And this has just been great. Wonderful thing. And thank you again for coming in. And there are so many of our veterans. You know, these are the sort of things that a lot of people don't know about. When you hear about them, it's bad enough, but the greatest part about it is not just hearing about it, but talking to you people who are doing something to help. And the other interesting thing is, notwithstanding these terrible stories we hear, we didn't hear anybody say, I don't like the military. Isn't that something? I don't dislike the military. America's Heroes Group, thanks everybody. Appreciate you being with us. We'll see you next week.
Accuser to testify, aid resignation. I'm Ann Cates. The woman who has accused Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh of sexual misconduct has agreed to testify before the Senate Judiciary Committee next week. Correspondent Ariane DeVogue on the concerns of Christine Blasey Ford.
Sources close to her have told me that she still believes that this hearing should be on Thursday. She still believes that the senators should ask the questions themselves. Remember, this committee on the Republican side is made up of men, and they have reserved the right.